welcome, Dhruv, to the mock interview today.
Thank you, sir. Good morning.
Good morning. So, Dhruv, tell us about yourself, your academic qualifications, your work experience after your graduation, and your main hobbies.
Sir, as you are aware, my name is Dhruv Khadia. I belong to the state of Rajasthan, but for most of my life, I have lived in Gujarat, in the Mehsana district. Sir, I have done my graduation in computer science and engineering, and my hobbies include watching TED Talks, analyzing football games. I'm very much interested in football tactics, and sir, I'm a very cheerful person who likes to make conversation with friends and family.
So, as I see from your DAF, and you mentioned just now, you are from Alwar in Rajasthan.
Yes, sir.
And the address, Mehsana, Gujarat.
Yes, sir.
Now, both the states are adjoining each other and have a lot of cultural similarities and heritage. So can you give a very brief account of Rajasthan and Gujarat from cultural point of view and from heritage point of view?
Sir, being the neighboring states, there are definitely a bit of cultural similarities that is there. Sir, this is very much notable in the language itself. The language, when Gujarati and Rajasthan, even though they have a different dialect, but a lot of words that are in Gujarati, they have the same meaning in Rajasthani also, sir. So that is one similarity. Secondly, sir, the coming to the heritage point of view, sir, the festivals that are being celebrated in both the Gujarat and Rajasthan, they are very much common, sir. As we can see during, sir, the January 14th, that is the Uttarayan, which is called in Gujarat. It is also called in Makar Sankranti in Rajasthan. And in both of the states, the kite flying festival is there. So apart from these similarities, so there are also a few cultural differences also. So firstly, the language that is spoken in Gujarat, it is predominantly Gujarati. But in Rajasthan, we see that a lot of people, they are using Hindi as a predominant form of communication. So that is one difference, sir. And
Yes, sir, that is it. That's it. Dhruv, just a few days back, the CEO of Google has made a statement that free and open internet is under attack globally, and several nations are restricting the flow of information. Can you give your comments on this statement of his?
Yes, sir. Sir, the statement is made in the backdrop of several nations that are imposing various type of internet crackdowns in the form of internet blockades, restricting what your users are posting on the social media websites. Also, sir, threatening various in big tech companies like Google and Twitter to make adjustments to their policy. So in this backdrop, the statement is made. But sir, personally, I believe that to make a statement on such a large context, sir, I don't agree that there is unnecessary restriction on the freedom of information and expression, especially in the digital media and in the internet medium, because a lot of these blockades that are being done are done for security purposes, and no right, like whether it is freedom of expression or right to internet, is absolute in nature. So I think, sir, in democracies, especially, these kind of restrictions, they are reasonable. But in various countries, that is, sir, we can see in the Myanmar, where a military junta has taken over. So there, sir, it is unreasonable.
Do you think this is at all applicable to India?
Yes, sir. To some extent, it is applicable. As we have seen, various reports, they have highlighted that the number of internet blockages India is one of the leading nations there. But sir, I think this is done because our security reasons, they are making us or forcing our hand at this. Recently, sir, we have also seen that the Jammu Kashmir, we have made few changes in that region also. And because of various actors involved that are both external and internal, that can disturb the peace process in the Jammu and Kashmir. So for there, sir, we have used this kind of process.
Good. You have mentioned that you have you've been with rural students and have done activities. So what did you engage them in?
Sir, I'm very proud of the work I did during the college period. Sir, the college NIT Delhi was situated in a very rural background. And I saw that a lot of people that are working in the nearby areas, they have students who went to school, but they were not performing well. And when they told us that you are studying in such a very high quality institute, that they also want their students to go there. So we decided that when our classes would end, we would hold an educative initiative where the students of our college would ask for these rural kids to come to the college after the closing hours, and we would try to help them in their studies. So this is the process that we did.
So Dhruv, you are a computer engineer and you have done so much for rural students. Tell me, if you have a village near Mehsana and you had to make it, you know, as a digital village, a robust digital village, how would you do it? And you have all the resources at hand.
Sir, firstly, I would try to get a survey of what is the current digital status of the village, whether there are any good community service centers there, what is the status of the panchayat there is, whether the internet connectivity is there. Secondly, what is the number of people that are having internet connection, whether at home or whether via mobile internet. So depending on it, my response would be the same. So if there are issues in these kind of areas, I will try to address them. At the government level, various schemes are there. That is, the panchayat connectivity scheme is there, the community service centers is there. So I would try to implement these schemes so that the internet reaches to them. Second thing, what we require to do is that, sir, even though people have mobile phones at home, they are not digitally literate. So for that, sir, I will try to ensure that various government schemes, that is Disha scheme, is there so that we can impart digital literacy there. Thirdly, sir, we have already various schemes that include digital access to resources, that is the PDS scheme and other schemes. But as mentioned before, sir, that they lack digital literacy. So I will try to hold mock drills or mock campaigns to make them aware about that these kind of things that are going on and how you can leverage them. So I think, sir, by doing so, I can set up a good foundation so that the village can be turned into a digital powerhouse.
Okay, Dhruv. So I now pass on Dhruv to Mr. Khanna. He will take the next round of questions.
Good morning, Dhruv.
Good morning, sir.
So, after 2017, after you completed your civil engineering, you have employed elsewhere?
Sorry, sir, can you please repeat? There was issues with the internet.
After your graduation and civil engineering, were you completely devoted to civil services preparation, or you had taken up any other job or assignment?
So after my graduation in the computer engineering, I have not been involved in any kind of work. I have devoted myself to the preparation for civil services.
So you think civil engineering will not offer you a good career in the private sector? That's why you are looking for government sector?
sir, I was offered a couple of jobs after I graduated, but my joining came very late. So I had the option, and civil services was always in my mind. Like I said, sir, during the college period, I did some educative initiatives towards the rural kid, which gave me a lot of satisfaction and pride. So I, while I was waiting for the job application to be arrived, I was also going through the other options, what I can do. And I found that civil services is one such career opportunity which will allow me to do so. And I always had, sir, a bit of inclination to the civil services as a child. So I felt that if I'm not doing any private job, then I will definitely have to try for the civil services.
So that means civil services is your plan B, and private jobs is your plan A. Does it mean that?
So as of now, I have devoted myself to civil services. So it is a plan A, but I've also kept a few plan B in my mind. That is the private sector jobs. And I've recently come across that various state governments, they are coming up with this urban fellowship program, that where they give opportunity to students to work with the administrators. So that is also, sir, my plan B, sir.
Okay, you are also from Gujarat, because that is the address mentioned. So let's talk a few things about Gujarat. Can you compare philosophy of Sardar Patel and Gandhi, and which philosophy you believe in, Patel's or Gandhi's?
Sir, Sardar Patel is being called as the Iron Man of India. So his policy, his philosophy is more on the stricter side, as it was seen when he played a major role in the integration of princely states. Whereas Gandhiji is more rooted in the ground, grassroots people. His philosophy is more of cooperation, satyagraha. So that this is the, sir, major philosophical difference that I can think of. Coming to me personally, sir, I believe I have a bit of mix of both of the aspects, sir. While I share my birthday with Gandhiji, I'm also inspired by the actions of Sardar Patel and what he did with his more pragmatic and more steely approach to ensure that the job is done. So I think, sir, taking good aspects of both, I think, sir, I would relate myself more with it, sir.
Okay, it is said that where governance ends, management begins. So would you like to elaborate on this statement, especially with respect to your experience?
Sir, can I please take a moment? Yes, sir. Sir, the quote that wherever government ends, management begins, it highlights that it is said in the backdrop of the Neuroid philosophy, which says that in today's world, there is role of private sector also, as much as the role of government is there. So that when in those areas where government don't have a lot of work to do, or where the government is not as efficient, it should give space to the private sector so that the management comes in. Because in government, the term administration is used, whereas in the private sector areas, the term management is used. So the quote is basically trying to tell us that in those areas where government is not required, the management should come in, and the management should play a role. So, and sir, I agree with it, because we live in a multi-actor paradigm where government is not the single most actor in the development process. So I think, sir, in those areas where government should have no business, it should leave, allow private sector to come in and provide the services that are there.
You have also studied in Delhi.
Yes, sir.
So recently Delhi came out with the MPD 41, Master Plan for Delhi 41. So what are the salient features of master plan for Delhi?
Sorry, sir, I will have to read about it.
All right, give me some architectural wonders of Gujarat and why do you consider them as architectural wonders from civil engineering point of view?
Sir, one of them is the Statue of Unity. It is also an architectural marvel because it is the highest statue in the world. So that is one of the area. Secondly, sir, I would like to give an example of another architectural marvel, which is in my district also. So it is called Bhotair Vav in Gujarati, and its translation, literal translation, is 72 caves. So it is a steep well, and it is organized in a way that it is having 72 caves in it. So it is also one of the architectural marvel present there. Another architectural marvel is the Modhera Sun Temple. So it is also it also has a steep well kind of structure ahead of it, and it also makes up a very good tourist attraction. So these are the few I can think of, sir.
Coming to Afghanistan, so how do you rate Afghanistan-Pakistan relations? Yesterday, Afghanistan president also spoke about Pakistan. So where you think Afghan-Pak relations are heading to? That is number one. And should India be worried about Taliban coming to power? Why should India worry?
Sir, I think the Afghanistan-Pakistan relation should be looked at from both official as well as non-official perspectives. At the official perspective, Taliban and Afghanistan government both have in the historically mentioned proximity to the Pakistan at the official level because they are neighbors. So that the relations become that much important for them. But at the non-official level, so it is seen that the Pakistan is also sponsoring or at least having some kind of connections with Taliban, because both have historically been seen as terrorist an area which has terrorist presence. So in that level, Pakistan's relation with that of Afghanistan should also be looked at. Coming to the second question, sir, I think the Taliban situation is very concerning for India, especially in the backdrop of US withdrawal, because it is giving a greater hand to the Taliban forces to control and govern the Afghani soil. And historically, sir, it is also being seen that they are not a non-violent partner, but they are very orthodox in their beliefs, and they do not respect any kind of democratic rights. So India being a democracy, I don't think, sir, the values will be same. And secondly, sir, a few good things that are still there for us is that even though Taliban claims to have controlled around 85% of their population territories, so I think majority of the Afghani population, it resides in the urban areas, which is still being controlled by the civilian government present there. Secondly, sir, sorry, sir, I forgot what I wanted to say.
Okay, no problem. Okay. Thank you. Over to you, Mr. Sumesh.
Thank you, sir. Yes, good morning, Dhruv.
Good morning, sir.
Okay. So, tell me, as a civil engineer, what are the issues with town planning in India and why we have a very less number of planned cities in India?
Sir, if I please like to make a correction, I am a computer engineer.
Okay, so you are a computer engineer. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so let me change my question. Okay. Okay, so let's move on to your optional subject, public administration. Okay. So can you tell me the difference between administration, management, and governance?
Thank you. Sir, fundamentally, if I were to make a diagram, then governance is a bigger circle under which the administration and management would come. The difference between administration and management in the fundamental sense is that administration is anything which is being done by the state machinery, and management is something which is done by the private organizations. And governance is something which includes the actions of both private sector, the government machinery, as well as other actors that are involved, whether there are religious organizations, whether there are civil society organizations, whether there are NGOs. So all of these actors, how they perform in order to achieve a common goal, that is the development, which is called governance.
Okay, so let us say you are DM of Mehsana, you are district collector of Mehsana. Tell me, how would you bring Atmanirbharta at grassroots levels in your district?
Sir, the district of Mehsana, it is very much known for its cooperative movement. We have a Doodh Sagar Dairy, which is one of the largest in Asia. So the seeds of Atmanirbharta has already been present in the Mehsana state. But sir, what we require is that because of there are large number of cattle animals, but we don't have veterinary services here. So firstly, we need to provide those veterinary services there so that the people who are having these kind of livelihoods based on the cattle animals, they can augment their income and move forward. Second thing is that sir, the presence of industrial activity is not that much high here in Mehsana. Apart from ONGC, there are no big industrial clusters are there. So that people are relying upon movement or transport to nearby centers. That is the Ahmedabad and Gandhinagar regions. So for that, sir, I think a lot of land is present in Mehsana to take up industrial activities. So I would invite many of the industrial players to come in so that they can set up food processing industries. So one of the food processing industries already present in Mehsana because of the dairy cooperatives, that is the Sahyog sweets. So it is, the literal meaning of Sahyog is cooperation. So this is also, sir, done by the local people themselves, and they are processing the dairy products into sweets. So I think, sir, these kind of cooperative and food processing industries, they can provide very much self-reliance to the people that are present in Mehsana, sir.
Government has no business to be in business. Do you agree?
Yes, sir. I agree to some extent, because in today's world, we cannot rule out the presence of private sector in various areas, whether it is telecom, whether it is automobiles, whether it is food products. Private sector has proved time to time again that they are better at service providing and as well as the improved quality, as well as the citizen satisfaction. But at the same time, sir, I think government presence is also required, because the private sector, it does not treat citizens as citizens, but it treats citizens as customers, and it only serves those who can pay. Sorry, sir. But the government, it also has the obligation to serve those who cannot be serviced by the private sectors. So in those areas, sir, I believe government presence should also be there. So I think while government has no business in doing business, the presence of government is also required, so that it does not leave out those who cannot be serviced by the private sectors.
Okay, so I would like to ask one more question on economy. Can you compare post-COVID economy recovery of India with China and US?
So the post-COVID economic recovery of India in comparison to the China and USA will be on a slower pace. Firstly, because the infection control in China was done in a very strict manner, so that the number of infection that we have is much less than we have. And comparing to the USA, sir, their vaccine drive has started to cover almost 50 to 60% of the population. And now their various sectors are opening up. So I think the post-COVID economy of these two countries will start at a faster rate than India. But I think as we move forward, because our vaccination around it is around 23%, and because the central procurement of a vaccine has been done, I think by the end of the year we are also going to be around 40 to 45% of the vaccine coverage in India. So I think by the end of the year we can start competing with these countries when it comes to post-COVID economic recovery. Secondly, sir, we are also seeing that many of these both the USA and China, many of these companies are now looking for alternatives because of the way the COVID has impacted these different countries. And India's recovery, good recovery, will also allow them different, a very vibrant domestic market to come and invest in India. So I think, sir, comparatively, we will do less in the beginning, but eventually, sir, I think we will not only catch up, but overtake them, sir.
One last question from my side, Dhruv. Tell me about any one of your hobbies and how it will be helpful for your career in civil services.
Sir, one of my hobbies is watching tech talks, and I like to watch tech talks that are mostly related to self-improvement. So one of the hobbies, one of the tech talks that I watched was given by Mr. Stephen Dunier. He said that by making small changes in your life, you can achieve big results. So he gave the examples of Novak Djokovic. He said that when he was winning 49% of his points, he was top 100. But when he won 52% of his points, he was top 10. So I believe that, sir, by making small and incremental changes, I can not only achieve big goals, but I can also ensure that the big goals that can be broken down into smaller components. And by solving these smaller components, I can achieve those big targets. So I think, sir, having this kind of learning, always learning and self-improving attitude that I have developed by watching TED Talks, it will help me in civil services, sir.
I pass on to Jim.
So Dhruv, this two states have come out with population policy, and UP in particular has released a draft population policy. Are you aware of it?
Yes, sir. I'm aware of it.
So can you just tell very briefly the highlights of this policy, and then I will come to the second point.
Sir, UP has released two particular documents. One is the draft bill, and second is the population control policy. So the draft bill contains various measures to incentivize population control, that include that if someone has more than two child, then they will not be given public services ration support and other public services. Also at the panchayat level, they will not be allowed to contest elections. And the policy which they have released, so it contains various provisions for a period of 2025, if I remember correctly. In this period, they will be incentivizing the population control by giving out educational awareness related to contraceptives, related to spacing between their children, so that their population or their total fertility rate can be reduced to 2.1, which is called the replacement rate, sir.
Dhruv, my main questions are two. What is your view about coming out with, you know, a population policy by the state? And number two, should the population policies be enacted or formulated by states separately, or should there be a national population policy to be by and large followed by all the states? What are your views about these two points?
Sir, I think the population policy that UP has released, it has a few good points. But I think that coming out with a policy that if you have more than two children, you will not be allowed government service. So I don't think it is a good step, because it is discriminatory towards poor people, because the urban people or the richer people who can afford to not avail government services, they are allowed to have more than two children. But the poor people who depend upon the government services, they will have to suffer the consequences of this policy. Secondly, sir, I also think that any kind of restrictive measures that are being imposed upon people, they have a tendency to have negative consequences in the form of corruption, in the form of having ghost beneficiaries, as it was seen in the case of China. So I think, sir, this policy has few good provisions that are related to the creation of awareness about contraceptives and ensuring that the population policy is done not via coercion, but also via awareness about amongst the people. Coming to the second question, sir, I don't think we require a national policy, because around 24 out of 29 states have already reached replacement level of the total fertility rate, or they are below it. So I think it is better if the states who are suffering from high total fertility rate, they come out with individual policy. But I think, sir, the provisions that are governing these population control policies, they should not be coercive in nature. Rather, they should be towards hand-holding and towards educating women as well as people about the contraceptive and the benefits of having two child.
So, Dhruv, we have finished with our choice of questions. The last question I'm offering you, if you can let me know any subject of your choice and you wish that I ask a question from that subject, I will ask the last question.
Sir, if it is possible, then I would like to talk more about my experience when I was doing the education initiative at the college level, sir.
Okay. So tell me the name of the initiative, one initiative, maybe I will then pose a question to you on that. Specify.
Sir, the name of the initiative that I did, or any initiative that is there.
You did. You are interested. I mean, you have to tell the subject. I will ask you a question from that subject.
Yes, sir. Sir, the initiative was called as Udaan. Udaan, where, sir, we went around the rural localities. We asked whether their children were facing any kind of issues in their education, and we offered them that at the end of around 5 to 7 p.m. every evening, we will hold them additional classes that will supplement their education. So these rural people, they were very much supportive of it, and they sent their kids to the college facilities. And while doing so, sir, we faced many challenges, but the outcome was while overcoming those challenges, sir, we feel that we contributed to something, and we managed to put on some kind of impact on the lives of their people.
Good. So Dhruv, we now formally finish the interview.
Dhruv,
yes, sir.
You have a very pleasing personality and positivity around you, sort of honesty in your approach. Your replies are very original. You think about it and you balance your replies. I really liked your comparison of Sardar Patel and Gandhi, because it was a ticklish question.
Yes, sir.
It could have led to some supplementaries, but the way you replied, you covered up both and did not give me a chance to ask you a supplementary question there. So that's something very good. Then on where governance ends, management begins, you gave a very good reply. So no issues there. It is governance, not the government.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Where governance ends, the management begins. So you gave a good reply. Since you have studied in Delhi, I asked you just as a awareness whether you know about Master Plan for Delhi 41. So if you are reading newspapers, you could have generally, you know, covered those four salient points of master plan of Delhi. Ultimately, anybody, any Delhiite who is reading newspapers should be interested in Delhi. So just one advice, that go through the current affairs and try and pick up all the important items like DEF. DEF shows you are studied in Delhi, then Gujarat, then Rajasthan. So any connectivity or otherwise of these three states, you should be prepared. Then your reply on why Taliban, what happens if Taliban comes to power? So you were speaking very fast. If you take a glass of water, slow down, then your thoughts will again come back to you. Not that you were short of ideas. I think it was in that hurry to speak up everything that you stopped. So in such a case, always better to have a sip of water and compose yourself and then reply. So overall, I liked your performance, your attitude, your personality, and your reply to why you want to become civil servant. So you are doing good. Just brush up on the current affairs and various issues. You are from Gujarat, so be prepared on Gujarat riots and Gandhi and you know, all the... I had jotted down a couple of more questions, but then due to shortage, so that is it. And technology will never leave you. You are a computer science person. So Digital India was asked. I think just look for the digital revolution in India that will happen in 21st century. Okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Over to you, Vinodji.
Yes, thank you. So, Dhruv, I don't have much to add. You have done very, very well. You are very impressive, very bright, well informed. You knew all the issues related to the questions. You were not just superficial, you were quite deep into it. You had the capability to analyze also. You were balanced in your approach. You could give the pros and cons of each of the controversial issue. Your Google CEO remark was very good. You analyzed it extremely well. And when it came to India, you were bold enough to mention some of the issues which had come. Similarly, same stand about population policy, very balanced approach. So that shows your personality also. I don't have much to add except to repeat what Khanna Sahab has mentioned. Firstly, that I too felt that you were speaking a bit too fast. It was nothing but excitement because you knew things so well, and it is easy for you to make it in a better conversation mode because the flow of thoughts is not a problem with you. The problem arises when somebody gets stuck for want of ideas, for want of information, for want of knowledge. You have knowledge in plenty, and you could cull out ideas even from the remotest of the subjects and topics that we raised. So from that angle, you should feel very confident. And so you could slow down a bit. And number two, which was more prominent, prominently visible to me, is that slightly in some questions you were stretching the answer slightly more than required. And this happened in one or two questions that I posed before you. you could be more brief. Now, two things I would like to tell you why, how you could be brief without compromising on the quality of content. One is that, you know, when you make a point, you don't have to explain and don't have to go into the details. For example, if you were making a point on digital village, you mentioned about digitally illiterate rural people. So I will teach or maybe impart education to the digitally illiterate people in that modern village. Right? That is enough. You don't have to explain that, you know, similarly, internet connectivity, I mean, it could have been more structured and point wise or very brief. Like, had I been in your place and with similar content that you mentioned to me, it could have been very simple. It's just that the thought should also come to you. Normally one repeats and one stretches because, you know, by the time you stretch, you get another idea. You know, that is another thing, especially in situation kind of questions. So you mentioned about the interconnectivity broadband. You also mentioned few things initially which were not required. Your answer should be immediately attacking to the main question instead of going around. Now, going around is required at times to retrieve an answer, right? If you were doing for that purpose, I have nothing to say. But if your ideas and thoughts were clear, maximum, instead of going around and hovering around the answer, you could just take 5 seconds pause before you start. And in those 5 seconds, you make up your mind, all right. Internet connectivity is one. Digital divide, that means digital literacy, is also very important. I need hardware. I need outlets. And you mentioned about, you covered everything, but it was a bit longer than what is required. So it could be made more crisp. This I saw in one more question. So just see how you can, control this temptation of speaking long. And the policy is that you stop when you have made your main points. If we don't have this feeling that maybe I have missed out something, maybe I missed out. Now that way you'll keep searching and keep talking something which is not very qualitatively good. फिर आपको करते करते एक और point याद आएगा. तो जहाँ पे आपको लगे कि substantial points, quality points मैंने बोल दिए हैं, you could put a full stop and pause. If the member has anything to ask you further, okay, Dhruv, what else? You know, then maybe by this time he asks, you can again search some more ideas. And if he doesn't ask and goes on to another question, it is fine with you. Are you getting my point? So, matlab answer ko kahan band karna hai, wo thoda sa art aap rehearsal mein kar lijiye. Or otherwise, you were excellent. And in fact, we had a good beginning of the day with a very bright boy. And we have rated you around 64% to 65% Dhruv, which is a very high rating from our angle, and which is very good to excelling category. I mean, we consider 70% as something, you know, which is excellent. Normally, you know, 64, 65 from UPSC standard is also pretty good. So with some of the improvements that we have mentioned, and with more, you have time, you can, you know, acquire more knowledge, current affairs, as Ganna Sahib has mentioned, Gujarat, Mehsana also. You could be asked a question on ONGC. Mehsana, you have ONGC, which is, so ONGC can take you to oil and natural gas area, right? Oil can take you to Gulf and OPEC and oil prices. So Mehsana, aapko एक वो जैसे वो चेन होता है ना, चेन, वो चेन बनाते बनाते वो कहीं से कहीं ले जा सकता है आपको. It can take you to Iran and Saudi Arabia also. So it is not just Mehsana that they will ask you, okay, what is Mehsana? What is the population? Mehsana is just the base to make many questions emerge from there. Similarly, computer, as Khanna Sahib has told, the entire digital India, you know, you have to, refresh again. Your poor family and rural students' exposure will open to all rural development things. So you have to be very careful about reading all the schemes which are in rural areas, you know, and likewise. And then, of course, your Rajasthan, your Alwar, NCR. Alwar can take you to NCR also. Right? Then economics, of course, is a very, at least 2-3 questions from economics and current affairs related to your DAF. So anything you want to ask us?
Yes, sir. Sir, I struggle mostly when it comes to questions that are related to international relations. So my biggest concern or the way I get confused is that, sir, every time an international issue is being asked, sir, most of the time I am preparing from the point of view of India, that how it can impact India. But when sometimes the core issue is asked and how that core issue can be handled, so there I struggle very much. So what can be done, or sir, how I can structure my answers so that it can be more focused towards India? Sir?
See, normally nobody will ask you that, you know, how is the latest relations between US and Russia? Now, if they don't make a mention of India, you could bring India, you know, into your answer. So there are two possibilities. They may just talk about, say, for example, American president and US, Russian president had met lately, and, you know, like a détente and no Cold War, peace talks, we should not fight. So these are all facts. Now, one question could be what impact this will have on the world politics, on the world economy. India is nowhere, right? So you have to mention what has been asked. At the end, just to show that, you know, you also have analyzed how this will impact India, you bring India in the end. For example, if this is a question, you would say ki, this kind of peace will certainly help to climate change. It will help in terrorism. It will help in controlling the pandemic. It will also help in containing the, you know, the latest activities of China, you know, something like that. And it will ensure peace in the world. And India, of course, would be one of the beneficiaries of, a very big beneficiaries of, you know, this, their, if there is a peace between them, if there is a friendship between them. This is how. Have I been able to answer your query?
Yes, sir. Sir, another question related to international relations, that, sir, there are various for organizations. For example, sir, Quad is there. Sir, in their official, whatever the countries have said, they have not mentioned China. So, sir, whether if in interview it is asked, sir, can we take a more practical approach towards it? That even though officially it has not been recognized, or that it is trying to counter China, but practically, sir, we can see that.
You must. Quad will be asked only from that perspective. If you miss out China, then your answer is not complete.
Sir, then I will also have to bring out whatever the practical or non-official stand is there.
It's your view. You are not a government spokesman. See, you are not Mr. Jaishankar.
Yes, sir.
You are giving your views. You are a citizen of India and you are being asked, you know, something about, you don't have to be acting like a spokesperson.
Yes, sir.
You defend what is right about the government, but you do defend. Don't be, on one hand, if you should not be like a spokesperson, you should also not be like a journalist. You know, yes, a political party sponsored journalist. Get my point? Or an opposition, sir. Or the leader of opposition.
Yes, sir.
Get it?
Yes, sir.
Give a very balanced, and I mentioned already, you have a very balanced view. You projected both parts. So China without Quad is useless.
Yes, sir.
Without making a mention of China, the question पूछने वाला ही इसीलिए पूछ रहा है कि Quad के पीछे एकदम से revive किया इतने सालों के बाद, it's because of to control China or monitor China in the Indo-Pacific area.
Yes, sir.
South China Sea, right? ये अलग बात है कि क्या Quad सही है या नहीं है. Quad में आप अमेरिका की तरफ झुक गए हैं. Are we a part of a block? You think that we are no longer non-aligned by, you know, inclining towards the United States?
Yes, sir.
Uska alag justification.
Yes, sir.
What else?
Yes, sir. That was it from my side.
So all the best, Dhruv.
Thank you very much, sir.
All the best, Dhruv.
Thank you, sir.
All the best.
Thank you, sir.